This is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today I have another exciting episode for you. And where I am today, I'm here in Salt Lake City, Utah. And the reason for this episode today is to show you guys a more sustainable way to live, right? I mean, just driving up through this neighborhood, you know, all I see is just a bunch of lawns. People mowing their lawn, people raking leaves. And, you know, the lawns take a lot of resources, you know, water, you know, fertilizer, and unfortunately chemical fertilizer, all these different things, but there is a better way, right? I want to encourage you guys to use your space that you have to grow food, not lawns, right? Maybe if you got some kids, you could have a small lawn, you know, the kids could play on the lawn, but I know a lot of you guys don't even have kids, so take out your lawn and grow food. So why I'm here today in Salt Lake City is to share with you guys actually a viewer's garden. Actually, this is a viewer that I just met today, actually. I was actually hanging out at a local health food store because I'm traveling right now, and I was looking for some food maybe to buy, some healthy to eat because the farmer's market's already ended for the year, or the one on Saturday anyways today. And he just like looked over at me and said, John Kohler. And I'm like, hey, what's up? And he recognized me and stuff. So we got to chatting, and here I am at his house. We've been chatting for a while, and he showed me his garden. I'm going to share with you guys his garden. And I really wanted to bring this episode to you guys because it's actually really cool. Anyways, let's go ahead and flip over to what he's doing in his yard. And while he still has some grass, he's also, you know, growing food in his front yard because there are no laws that disallow growing food here in the front yard. All right, so what we're looking at behind me is the viewer. His name is Rory. This is his front yard, and as he has some, you know, grass, he also has a nice area where he has some fruit trees. So if you still want to kind of blend into the neighborhood and not like convert your whole front yard like I did, right? This is a really good modern approach by maybe making some kind of like area that you could plant some fruit trees. So he has like a nectarine tree here that produced over 200 fruits this year. It's actually not even that tall than a peach tree over on that side in this area. And in this front area here, he also grew things like cantaloupe and other vegetables that have now been pulled out because it is, you know, basically past their summer growing season. In addition, you know, more closer to his house, he has some Jerusalem artichokes or sunchokes, as well as some other herbs and things growing back by his house. And so, you know, you could fit in some more decorative edible plants in your front yard to make a more, you know, better use of your space than just growing grass that you're not going to use and has no functional purpose. Now, aside from the edibles here, he's also growing some kind of other, you know, bedding plants and whatnot to attract beneficial insects. And that's also very important, something I'm learning that's really important, that especially if you're not going to be growing all food crops like I am, it also would probably be really wise to behoove you to grow some other plants to attract beneficials, as well as, of course, native plants. And especially if you have a larger property, you know, just grow a buffer zone of these plants around your property, you know, to buffer it from the outside world, all right? So the main reason why I really wanted to bring you guys this episode is not just because like he's growing a couple cool things and stuff, but it's the way in which he's doing it, right? He purchased this house about 8 years ago, and for maybe like about the first 4 years, he was basically doing the style of gardening that I teach. You know, basically he would have a raised bed in the backyard that I'll show you guys in a little bit. He'd basically spread down the compost and plant and stuff in there, and then, you know, and then life happens, right? And then his wife got pregnant, and about 2 years ago they had a baby, and so he found himself with much less time to do all the gardening and all the maintenance. So what I'm going to share with you guys next, actually take you guys to the backyard and show you guys a really low maintenance garden, number one. So it's going to save you guys labor, save you guys time, so you have time to go to work, play with your kid, you know, play with your wife, I mean, whatever you got to do besides just gardening and spending time in the garden every day, which I like to do. And, you know, for me, that's part of my relaxation and fun. But, you know, in this instance, he literally doesn't have the time to do that. And in addition, the other thing, aside from being, you know, this garden being, you know, not having a lot of time input into it, right? The other things that are amazing is that he doesn't actually water it, right? That's pretty huge. And so water, it's becoming a big issue. And you know, but plants out in nature, like even if you drive through the desert, right, you see plants growing out there. How are they growing even though it's the desert and it like barely rains in the desert, right? They've learned how to adapt to low water situations. And if you build your soil just right, which is another thing he's doing here, he's doing the no-till version of gardening, you could actually ensure that your soil will capture more water and let that off to your plants, and it'll be more fertile and nutritious than the next guy that has to keep watering his lawn, you know, sometimes twice a day. And so that's really why I want to show this to you guys, because this is a no-till, so that's a, you know, decreasing the workload, no water, which is amazing, not having to water his garden all season long, and number three, you know, very little time or effort has been put into it, aside from, of course, maybe planting it out in the spring and getting it going. And of course, you know, when he does plant out in the spring, he's watering things in just to get them established. But once they're big enough, then he's like, you know what, they need to fend for themselves, they need to find the water, and all that good stuff. So anyways, let's go ahead to the backyard and share with you guys how you guys could have a no-till garden. You don't have to water, they have to pay little attention to. All right, so now I'm about to head in to Rory's backyard to share with you guys his garden back there, and also some of the fruit trees and some of the amazing plants that are still producing even this late in the season. You know, his cucumbers are pretty much ripped out, his peppers are pretty much done, his tomatoes are done, cucumbers are done, all the major summer crops are done. So there's still some things hanging on. But the amazing thing is the way he's been actually enriching his soil, which is there's a few ways, and one of those is these guys right here, wood. So he's not using big logs, he's not doing hugel culture here, but what he is doing is he's using chipped wood or wood chips, you know, as one of the ways to add fertility to his garden. But more importantly than just simply adding the fertility, he's creating an environment that is conducive to, you know, growing bacteria and fungi, earthworms, that are gonna also produce fertility for him so that he doesn't have to, you know, do it himself and bring in these organic fertilizers in a bag, right? The only two main things he adds in any large quantities are compost and the wood chips, right? So anyways, let's go ahead and check out his garden in the back. So the first thing I wanna do is introduce you to Rory's garden right there, which is basically just fenced off because he's got some dogs. It's about maybe 12 feet by about 50 feet long, and he's basically recently expanded into a new area, and he's gonna basically make the whole back of this side, on the back side next to the fence, a garden. And basically he's doing some experiments over there. So, you know, I'd always encourage you guys to do experimenting. You know, he's learned a lot of things from my videos and other online teachers that he's read in different forums and whatnot. And he's implementing the things that make sense to him, and he's gotten a lot of good results from them. And he's really excited about the things he's learned and the things he has done to be successful. So stay tuned for the end where I'll be interviewing him and talking more about some of the specifics of what he does to have a successful garden here in Salt Lake City. But yeah, that's the basic garden. You guys can see like a lot of the stuff kind of needs to get pulled and all this kind of stuff. And you know, because he has a kid, you know, he's behind on doing stuff, and he had no idea that I'm gonna show up today. But that's cool because, you know, this is just what it is. And I know, you know, my garden gets like this sometimes when I get, you know, too much stuff to do, and we get a frost, and I gotta deal with all this stuff and compost and all this stuff and remove it and top off my beds and stuff. But you know, he's got his workload down to a minimum because he's learned how to really you know, save time by doing certain practices. So for some of those practices, what we're gonna do now is actually go into the garden and show you guys some of the techniques he's using to be successful to grow, you know, without spending a lot of time in his garden. So this is just the one part of his garden, his more experimental side, and he has a number of crops like comfrey and different kinds of berries, and he's got the sunchokes back here, and this is pretty much kind of like a wild garden. You know, he lets a lot of things just kind of grow wherever they want, and he lets, you know, the plants figure it out. He got a root beer anise over here, mint is growing, there's some tomatoes that probably need to get pulled out. He's got strawberries along the fence line. I'll share with you guys something really interesting about strawberries that I learned today. But this side of his garden, you know, and you guys may see a fence back over there. Anyways, from that fence line to this section that I'm standing in, basically what he's done, he's just basically adds on compost on the top, and then he grows the plants in. And what he's seen by doing this is that, you know, especially comparing this to the other side, which we'll talk about in a minute, you know, the plants get put in and they have a nice growth spurt pretty fast, but then they kind of like taper off, right? And that's just kind of what he's noticed, because like the nutrients are more available because they're already the compost that's ready to get taken up. Now, he does do other things besides just bring in the compost. As I said, you know, he brings in a lot of compost and wood chips, which are primarily what he's bringing in, but he's also adding other things to create fertility in his soil, including the rock dust, including the azomite, including the basalt style rock dusts. You know, he adds those in to the garden as well. He also adds things like his homemade compost tea recipes to add more fertility. He also adds an aloe vera powder that he's really excited about, that he swears like makes everything grow faster. So, you know, I have some aloe powder. I haven't actually used it yet, but when I get home, I'm probably gonna start using it. So that's really cool. And I guess that's this side of the garden. I mean, I could show you some of the plants. Some of them are looking pretty jacked up at this point. And, you know, some of them are good to harvest seeds, actually, like the mountain orach or orach over there. That's like his favorite leafy green that he grows. But anyways, let's head over to the other side, which is really what I want to show you guys. And this is the way that he's been doing primarily. And I like that actually he has this other side garden to kind of compare to see what's growing better and how it's growing different. And once again, you know, I encourage you guys to always experiment to see what happens, you know what I mean? Life's just a fun kind of game. You get to just kind of see what happens, especially when you're gardening, right? All right, let's go ahead to the other side. So before I get into like actually taking a look at the soil on this side of the yard, I really want to kind of cover some of the plants that he's growing that actually take some of the labor out of growing your food. If you guys are a longtime viewer, you would know recently, you know, I was in Costa Rica and, you know, talked about growing more perennials and perennial style crops that are lower maintenance. So for example, you know, he grows many different perennial crops, including broccoli and berries and some herbs and even some of his, you know, greens that come back year after year, whether they're coming back because a root system is staying alive underneath the ground, or whether they come back because, you know, the plant goes to seed and then they drop seeds and then they just basically sprout up on their own, or whether it's like the Jerusalem artichokes, which are a perennial, because the tubers will stay alive under the ground during the winter and then pop out next spring. And actually those, they're kind of hard to get rid of once you got them, but that's a good thing because you're gonna have pretty much unlimited, you know, starch-based or carbohydrate-based food sources that are just buried under the ground waiting for you guys to dig them up. But even here late in the season, when tomatoes and peppers and all these things are done, he still's got these guys. These are raspberries. I don't know if you guys can see these here, but he's still got these like yellow raspberries on his plants right here. And they're delicious. I want to encourage you, wow, these are really good. I want to encourage you guys, you know, to grow some berries. They're some of the most nutritious fruits you guys could be growing, especially the dark and deep, rich pigmented berries. I'm actually growing some black raspberries that I really like a lot in my garden. All right, next, let's take a look at some of the soil and see some of the soil practices that he's doing on this side of the yard that really allows him to not have to water his garden for the full season. So now we're on the other side of the garden, and I'll share with you guys actually what he's done on this side so that he can conserve water and literally make the soil like a sponge, you know, that'll then suck up the water and then release it as the plants need it over the season, right? Soils in America are being degraded, right? The organic matter is decreasing. And when the organic matter decreases, the water holding capacity of the soil also decreases, but at alarming rates. By every, you know, percentage of organic matter drop, water holding capacity goes down much, much more than just single digit percentages, like a lot. I don't know the exact numbers. But what he does on this side is actually a no-till gardening method. So, you know, at the end of the season, like it is now, basically he's gonna just basically, you know, cut down all the top growth and compost them, leaving the roots intact. And in some cases, he's just actually gonna cover the whole plants up you know, with some compost and or wood chips, right? Compost him in place to add more fertility to his land and add more organic matter to his land. So on this side, what he did was he basically piled up compost because his grass level, which is where the soil level of the backyard would have been, is probably at least a good, you know, 8 inches below where it is where I'm sitting now. So he brought in a lot of compost on the bottom layer, and then on top of the compost, he layered up a bunch of the wood chips, right? And then he planted in the compost. So he kind of like, you know, pushed back the wood chips to plant in the compost. And then he let everything grow. And this is about, I think, 3 years ago or so that he put down the wood chips. And so now the wood chips have been sitting here breaking down, also providing a layer of mulch to prevent evaporation. He was covering the soil that way. Also, when it rains and water comes, you know, the water, the rain goes on the wood chips and will basically wash in nutrients because there's things, bacteria and microbes and earthworms that are eating the wood chips and creating more fertility, and the rain washes this all in. You know, here in Salt Lake City, unlike places that I'm used to, it snows in the winter, so they'll get snow up to here, and over the spring, you know, once it, you know, once the snow melts, guess what snow is? Snow's frozen water. Yeah, I'm a genius, figured out. But when the snow melts, guess what? And the snow is melting slowly. It doesn't like disappear all in one day. So the snow is melting slowly, releasing the water into his soil slowly so that it can capture it and not run off. So it gets captured in all the different wood chips and all the organic matter. And it's there ready for his plants to uptake throughout the whole season. And provided his organic matter is high enough and the weather is not too hot, he will have enough moisture and water holding capacity in his soil to allow his plants to grow the entire season like he has here. Of course, it also may be beneficial to grow certain plants that have less water requirement needs and or are more wild, that actually don't really need that much water, like actually one of them that I'll show you guys in a minute. But what I want to do next actually is scratch back some of this soil, give you guys a close-up on what's going on in his soil and, you know, why this is working for him. So now we're on the side of the garden that has gotten the wood chips, and we're gonna go ahead and show you guys the wood chips in a second. But I wanna explain some of the practices Rory does to increase the soil organic matter, and more importantly, the microlife, or the bacteria, the fungi, the arthropods, the nematodes, the earthworms, everything that's living in the soil below my feet. So number one, he has designated pathways. That's very important. You know, he has walkways where he walks through the garden. He just doesn't stomp over every, you know, square inch of the garden. He walks on certain paths so that he's not compacting the soil. This is very critical, right? And I want to encourage you guys to do this practice in your garden. You know, I personally use raised beds. I rarely, if ever, walk in my raised beds. You know, I have pathways that I could walk on either side of my raised bed to reach in 2 feet, because my raised beds are 4 feet wide. I could reach in 2 feet from either direction so I could access my raised beds without walking on it and compacting the soil. That is not good, you know, for the soil microbiome. Another thing he does, and that he's done on this side, is he's taken his, you know, standard level of soil or his backyard, and he's raised it up. So he's dumped on compost for a section of it, and then he's dumped on top of that wood chips on this side of the yard, right? This is also adding fertility so that he can do the no-till, because the compost is instantly rich and full of nutrition, and the wood chips are basically adding a protective cover to his garden, to the soil, to protect all the valuable microbes below. Plus, if you guys look, you know, around, like, he has lots of different things growing everywhere, including maybe non-desired plants that are actually filling space and growing, but also have roots and are growing things in this whole space, because you know, actually growing a plant in itself, whether it's a desired one or undesired one, will help to increase, you know, the biomass that you'll be later adding back to your garden, but also adding more root zones, which is where many of the different bacteria and microlife and soil life live on the root zone or near the root zone of your plants. So keeping the soil covered with the wood chips and or the plants, and then of course he adds the wood chips on the top, which fully keeps the soil covered. So this prevents, you know, moisture to evaporate off the soil. It also keeps it covered. You know, we wouldn't go outside without clothes on in the winter, and you know, in my opinion, you should not have your garden, you know, exposed to the elements in the winter, especially if you're taking the winter off. I personally, in my climate, try to grow all, I do grow all year round, so you know, my soil is never bare. I always have plants, and I try to plant my plants close enough so that, you know, there's very little sun exposure onto my soil. Of course, the mulch is also good, you know, because it protects the soil. Oh, shit, I already said that. So now I want to share with you guys another reason why the mulch is so good, because mulch, as much as it does protect the soil and the wood chips are protecting the soil, it also creates fertility later on. So the wood chips that are still left in the garden here were applied 3 years ago, and this year he's going to be reapplying some new wood chips to the garden to add further fertility to this side of the garden and also enable him to capture more water. The thing that I didn't really talk about yet is that, you know, when you have more organic matter, and once again, compost, what is that? That's organic matter. You know, wood chips, that's organic matter. When you have more organic matter, you know, the water holding capacity of the soil goes up. But for every 1% of soil organic matter increase, right, the soil water holding capacity doesn't go up like 1%. It goes up astronomically, you know, more, much more. You know, so that your soil could now hold water. And I'm not used to really places like Salt Lake City, where just in a couple months there's going to be snow up to here sitting on this garden where I'm sitting now. And the cool thing about snow is that it's 100% frozen water, right? That's what snow is. And check it out, when it becomes spring next year, that snow that's, you know, up to here will slowly melt. And it'll slowly melt and release the solid water into liquid water that's then gonna flow into the garden right below me, into the wood chips, into all the soil and the organic matter. And the soil organic matter will hold on to this water and release it at a slow pace for all the plants that are growing here. Furthermore, the water will sink down and all the organic matter will hold on to this, so now the roots could go down and they'll be able to find their water they need to grow. And I mean, I just think it's simply amazing that this whole garden here, aside from maybe watering some transplants and some baby seedlings that he's planted in, you know, when they're babies, all this stuff he's saying he hasn't watered during the whole season, which is just blows my mind, because I could maybe do it in one of my gardens, but the other garden, you know, where it's so arid and dry and over 100 degrees every single day, I don't think that's gonna maybe be possible. But, you know, who knows? And I encourage you guys to always try and experiment and try this style of gardening if you haven't already. Dedicate one raised bed to doing a style similar to this. Anyways, let's go ahead and take a look at this soil and show you guys another way the wood chips are adding fertility to the soil. So now I want to give you guys a close-up of the soil here and the wood chips after they've been broken down over about 3 years. You know, they're adding fertility to the soil, because check this out, we could just go ahead and dig back some of these wood chips right here. And if we look underneath here, you know, it's nice, rich, and black. Look at this soil right here. It's like really dark. These wood chips just break down into a really nice soil. Something that you guys should be amending your soil with, either broken down wood chips is what I do, because I don't want to let the wood chips break down on site, because they can cause some challenges, as we will learn in a little bit. But also, you know, I'm seeing down in here like earthworms and things that are, you know, eating the wood chips and the bacteria and just having a party down here. Lots of microbial growth and some fungal hyphae and whatnot, and it's all these, you know, bacterial life is really required for growing, and that's what basically he's providing a good habitat or environment or home for these creatures to make it all happen. And I think this is very useful, and the wood chips can play an important role in your vegetable garden, but also, more importantly, in other areas of your garden. So what I want to do next is actually show you guys a few more areas of his garden where he's using some wood chips with positive results. So besides just having a standard vegetable garden here, Rory also grows some fruit trees as well as some vines and fruit shrubs that I'll introduce you guys to in a minute. And especially if you want a low maintenance garden, right? Fruit trees require much less maintenance than like a vegetable garden. So I would encourage you guys, especially if you own your own house, like plant some fruit trees. Even if you're not going to do anything else, plant some fruit trees and feed them properly. And it's really easy to feed and take care of your fruit trees. We're going to go down to the end and show you guys an apple tree that he's had. Actually, that was the first fruit tree that he planted on the property like 8 years ago. And what he's doing to create fertility with the apple. But before that, I want to take you actually over to this pear tree and show you guys like the amazing pruning job he's done, and give you guys an idea on how you guys should prune your fruit trees for maximum fruit production. All right, so this is his pear tree right here, and I really like the pruning job he did on this particular tree. It's pruned well. I mean, we think of a tree with like a single, you know, trunk that comes up to big massive growth on top, right? But you know, that may not be the best way to grow trees, especially for fruit production. What he's done here I like a lot, because basically he's encouraged a lot of the out branching of the fruit tree. So you guys could see like this is more of a tree shrub than a full tree, because it actually gets really wide. So this is like if you're doing espalier, you'd only have it in two planes, but this goes planes all around. So the tree kind of grows out and then it grows up. So I really like this example to show you guys, because this means that there'll be more fruiting spots for the tree, but also all this, aside from the center lead here, is that I could reach by hand and not have to get a ladder out, you know, to harvest the tree. So yeah, I just wanted to show you guys that real quick and give you guys on some ideas on how maybe you guys should do some pruning pretty much like this. So next I'm going to share with you guys his pink lady apple tree here. This is the first thing that he planted, and when he originally planted this, he didn't know about organic gardening or anything, and he just used miracle crap fertilizer because he didn't really know any better. Then later he kind of thought about like, man, there gotta be a better way, and he started trying to figure stuff out. He got some like organic compost and started doing that. Then he found my videos, you know, then he started actually adding things like the rock dust, you know, the compost, worm castings. Later he started adding like compost teas as well as the aloe powders and whatnot that he's watering in. And of course also using the wood chips to add fertility to his tree. And looks like it's working. You know, he's left some of the bird pecks fruit out for the birds, right? And I encourage you guys, when you have abundant harvest, right, leave some for the wildlife and the other creatures on this planet aside for us. You know, for me personally, some of these guys, like, they're still good to eat. I would just cut off the bad spots and eat the other half. And actually, you know, I find that some of the fruit that the birds get, right, I don't know how, but birds have a really good sense of like the best fruit on the tree, and those are the ones they're going to go for. So those are some that we should be eating ourselves, right? Of course, you could also cover this tree with a netting, but then also try to make sure that birds don't get in there and get caught and lose their life or something like that. And he could also basically, in Japan, they basically cover each individual fruit in a little bag to protect each individual fruit. That can take some time, but another way to ensure that he's going to be eating his apples instead of the birds, all right? Next thing I want to do is actually take you guys down to the base of the tree and show you guys actually how he's creating fertility, and also how he's not having to water his fruit trees and they're still producing abundant amounts of fruits. So now what we're looking at is the base of the apple tree here, and you can see some of the smaller fallen fruit that's immature, maybe not so good, whatnot, damaged fruit. And he'll leave that and just let the apple tree feed itself with the apples. Also, when he comes in and prunes this, he'll just drop the pruning branches and whatnot down below and let those break down and feed the tree. So, you know, one of my friends taught me the best food for trees are trees. And besides the tree itself, of course, he lets the leaves drop, compost in place. But in addition to that, he brings in additional nutrients in the form of the wood chips that are right here that he's put down two times over the years, and he basically just lets them break down. And if we, number one reason for the wood chips is because it's adding fertility. Number two is because it also holds that moisture and, you know, feeds the tree. It also prevents soil evaporation. It also, once again, provides protection of the soil and the microbes in the soil, but also provides a really good home for the microbes to encourage their growth. It's very important. But if we just peel back some of this, it's even more impressive underneath the tree here that he's actually piled up, you know, more wood chips recently than the garden. I mean, it's really nice, rich, and black. Like, I want to take a screen here and just sieve out some of this black stuff here and take that into my garden. There's all these little, creatures in here. I'm seeing some worms, some roly-polies, some spiders, all these kind of things, and they're doing their job to, you know, eat the organic matter, eat different creatures, and make their poop, make worm castings in the place, and guess what? All those things end up feeding the tree so it could be healthier. So yeah, wood chips, very valuable. Now, my personal belief is that I think wood chips are, you know, pretty much a no-brainer and should always be done on your trees. Always feed trees other trees. In vegetable gardens, you know, that's where it can be a pro or a con, you know. Wood chips may attract, you know, pests. So, like, I found that when I did wood chips in my garden, got a lot of snails and creatures and bugs and things hiding in there that would then come out and eat my vegetables, you know. And so we'll talk more about Rory about this with his experiences with the wood chips in his vegetable garden. I think I want to cover one more plant here today before we sit down with Rory and interview him about everything he's doing here. And actually it's right over across the yard, and it's one of the most impressive berry plants that I've seen in my life. So the most impressive plant that I've seen here today, which I would call a shrub, is this guy right here. Now, I don't know if you guys know what this is. I'm growing one myself. This is known as the goji berries. And if you guys look at this closely, like, I don't know how it shows up on the HD camera, but like every different orange little globe thing, those are all berries. Here's some that I picked. You guys can see them in my hand. But this thing is just full of loaded berries. And I'm not gonna say all the berries are perfect. I mean, yeah, some of them are dried out, some of them are bird pecked, some of them are whatever, but there's plenty of ripe fruit on here for the pickings even after all the crops of the summer garden has gone, you know, the way of the West. And the thing for this is that, you know, he hasn't used wood chips on this because he can't get it even into the base of the plants now because this thing has just grown so massive. I don't even think he's pruned this because underneath here is just all the dried out old wood from previous years. He's only added compost and rock dust, and then he does not water his goji berries on purpose. And look what happens. He's blessed with tons and tons and tons of fruit, probably more than he could eat, right? So I think preserving the goji berries by, like, maybe freezing them, using them in smoothies, or maybe like dehydrating them into like dried goji berries that if you go to like the health food store is like, I don't know, $20-$30 a pound, or even better yet, what I want to do one day is freeze dry my goji berries. That's gonna be totally insane. Can't wait for freeze dried goji berries. But yeah, goji berries are very high in antioxidants. They're a Chinese traditional medicinal food, you know, that you guys should be eating. If you guys want to, you know, get some goji berry plants, they can be hard to find. You could also actually even sprout the goji berry seeds and eat the goji berry sprouts, which are very nutritious, I learned. But anyways, if you want to grow your own goji berries, what you're going to want to do is go to a health food store, buy some goji berries. Maybe they'll have them in the bulk section. Maybe you might have to buy a package of the, you know, dried goji berries and take them home. And basically, the dried fruit, you could actually open up the fruit and take the seeds out. Those will germinate into plants for you guys so you guys can grow your own goji berries. And maybe, just maybe, if you're lucky, have good soil practices and don't water your goji berries. You know, give them a tough time and let them fend for themselves, because that's what they do out in nature, right? They'll grow out in nature in the desert and they'll produce copious amounts of goji berries because these plants are really strong. They've had to fight to find water and they've had to live out in the wild. You know, this is more of a wild plant than a domesticated, you know, lettuce, for example, that we've hybridized and made into what we want. So I really want to encourage you guys also at the same time to eat some wild foods, and more importantly, grow more wild foods, you know, like the sunchokes that he's growing here. He actually has some sunchokes over there in several spots that are growing pretty wild on their own. And the wild foods always will grow better for you than some of the domesticated ones. So yeah, focus on some of the wild stuff, including these goji berries. So I'm gonna go ahead and eat this whole handful I picked. These are some of the best fresh goji berries I've tried. Sometimes, especially during the heat, they can be really bitter. These, I wouldn't say they're like sweet, like an apple or like a strawberry or something. They got a little bit of tartness, but they're quite good, and they're really rich in antioxidants. I really want to actually bridge test these goji berries to kind of see where they're at, and then be able to compare goji berries to like these ones as like the standard to which I will weigh all other goji berries until I try something better. So now I'm with Rory, and he's the gardener here, the owner of the property, who's basically made all this happen. And we're gonna go ahead and ask him some questions today. So, hey Rory, how did I end up meeting you today?
So I was just going to a grocery store that is a natural grocery store, and it's an all local food store here in Utah. And my really good friend is actually the manager, so we go there all the time. And I'm chasing my son around the store, and I look down the vegetable aisle, and who do I see but John Kohler here. So I had to go up and give him a big handshake and tell him I love all his videos, and then we just started talking.
Cool, yeah, then I'm like, hey man, I don't got anything to do this afternoon. I'd love to check out your place and see what you're doing, and I really love what he's doing here with especially all the wood chips, and to find out that he actually doesn't water this place like during the growing season, that just like boggles my mind. It is possible if you do it right, and you know, it may take you years to dial in, and it depends on where you live. So if you live in Salt Lake City here in the area and do things exactly like he does, you could probably get away with it because it works for him. But of course, if you live in Las Vegas, try to don't water during the year and do what he's doing, you may not have as successful results, of course, you know. So Rory, what really motivated you to like grow and do this no-till method where you actually don't water anything? It's kind of incredible.
Yeah, so what first started me is John here, obviously, with all of his no-tilling. He pretty much is a no-till gardener, just in his own way. He never tills, he tries not to step on the soil, adds all the fertility in massive amounts. And that's what a lot of people think nowadays, that the garden doesn't need all this massive amount of fertility, but it's what makes everything flow. So I've been going around talking to gardeners and garden shops all around my area, and I almost feel like the black sheep, that no one knows anything about organic gardening or cares. So then just watching John Kohler's videos just started me going. And then I had a son about 2.5 years ago, and then gardening became a little bit harder. He was born in January 2.5 years ago. That winter I saw a video about Paul from Garden to Eden about wood chips, and then that really inspired me, because you put everything down like John does and then you cover it, and then it pretty much just, for an easy way to say it, won't let it escape again. Keeps it in place. So I did that, and then started experimenting just to see if this side will do better with the wood chips and this side will do better with compost. And it's just pretty interesting to see the difference, because the compost side, you get instant fertility with the compost breakdown, feeds the plant's roots immediately. And this side, you get wood chips breaking down, but you get them, the first year is kind of iffy, you got to put some fish meal around it, a little bit of fertilizer maybe to get it going, but then after that, everything just grows amazing. So it's like a savings account you're putting on in nutrients, and then your checking account is your compost. You're just throwing it on, and then it's using whenever you need to use it. So that's the big kind of difference I see there. So Paul and John are the ones that got me going big time.
Cool.
In this whole thing.
Right on. So let's talk about rock dust. You know, I know, especially when you're around here, and actually for those of you guys that don't know, here in Salt Lake City, just, you know, the azomite is mined maybe like an hour away from here. But even though azomite is from an hour away mined in a mine here, like, he couldn't find it around here. And so why is rock dust so important for you? And why do you believe it's one of the, you know, key ingredients on why you're having such good results in your garden?
The minerals feed the life. They feed the enzymes, which feed the next smallest microbe that feeds the next biggest one to the biggest one to me. So I get the minerals to the microbes. The microbes will eventually give the minerals to the plants, and then I'll eat the plant, and it's win-win for everyone. The microbes thrive, we thrive with health. So minerals are the key pretty much to all foundation of life, I feel like. So that is one of the most important things you could put into your garden. And if you're a garden tiller, never take rocks out of your garden. Rocks are minerals. They break down to minerals. They are aeration. They're very helpful. So minerals, rock dust, azomite, all of them are so important. And just like John was saying earlier with the bricks, you can literally do season to season growing and testing and add minerals over another season and test, and the bricks will go up. So if you keep doing this, who knows where you'll end up, somewhere good.
Cool, right on. Yeah, so the other thing, you know, as much as I talk about the minerals are really important, you know, I've seen people that have used the minerals and then maybe they don't get the results directly from the minerals like that season, and then they're quite upset. And what people don't understand is, like, you know, what Rory is doing here, he's adding the minerals, but he's also adding the compost, the wood chips, as well as other, you know, inoculants, you know, that adds the microbes so that they make the minerals available for the plants. And this is a very important key. You know, if you're just adding minerals and still using chemical fertilizers, you know, the minerals are in, they could just not even be there anyways because they're not really even important. That's really important. So Rory, let's talk about that next. Like, how do you activate the minerals, like, you know, your compost teas, and what's this aloe stuff that you've been spraying down, and what does that do?
So the compost tea, first off, is chock full of microbes. And I'm not a scientist, and don't quote me, but supposedly they say in like a teaspoon of compost tea, there's more life in that teaspoon than all humans on the planet. So if you give that compost tea in the right clean environment to where you're not brewing or creating any bad bacteria or microbes, you will give the most life to your garden that you can. And you can spray this on your leaves as pest control, as fungus control, all kinds of stuff, and then you water it in. But when you water it, it builds up the microbes so fast that it will actually go and attack, not attack, but it will go and break down these minerals even faster and feed them to your plants with all the micro life in the soil. And then with aloe vera, as John knows, and you can go back on his videos to Mike Haley and Aloe One, aloe is one of the most medicinal, beneficial plants in the world. It has been sought out by kings, queens, princesses, everyone. They say Nefertiti used it for all of her beauty, all the Egyptian queens. So I saw a video from John with Mike Haley about aloe and how it's so healing to the human body and stomach. So, and then I started, just kind of blew that off and started gardening more. And then I read a study on aloe vera and plant health. So when you give the aloe vera to the plants, it feeds the feeder roots, and the feeder roots go out and become longer and bigger and absorb all the nutrients into your food, into the plant. And then what those feeeder roots are literally is the pretty much the immune system of the plant. Mm. So the more feeder roots, the longer feeder roots, the healthier the feeder roots, the immune system goes up, the PAR resistance in the plant goes up, and the health in general. So you can take full aloe leaves, blend them down, strain them through cheesecloth, and add that at 1/4 a cup per gallon to your water. Spray that on your plant and water into the plants, and they will love it. The immune system boosts, the roots expand, the plants pray, they just freak out, and the babies love it. You can use it on transplants instead of B vitamins, which are not very healthy or good for you or your soil, not the B vitamins we take, but a lot of these B vitamins they sell in bottles, if you read and get into them, they are really bad for your health. So aloe vera is one of the number one transplant revivers. You can give aloe to any transplant, and the next day that plant will look like it has been established for weeks. So the main thing is the aloe vera in the soil feeds the enzymes that start the breakdown of everything. So once you start to feed the enzymes, they will break down the organic material and it will just become a quicker life cycle. Just everything moves faster. The plant lives off the aloe in health and humans. And then I went back after I learned this, went back to John's video with Mike Haley and listened really closely again. And then I put it together that our stomach, our small intestine, has a villi in it, which are little hairs that are in your intestine, and food flows through that, and the hairs literally pull out the food. And then I started thinking, like a crazy person, I guess, that the villi and the plant's feeder roots are really similar. Mm. So if I give the plants this and they react like that, it must be as good as human for humans, as everybody says.
Yeah, absolutely, you know. And what he's really doing here, he's actually, you know, he's not really like adding and giving fertilizers to his plants. He's actually building the soil with all these different things, the wood chips, the rock dust, the aloe, the compost teas. He's building soil and the soil microbiome to make that healthier. And that makes his plants more resistant. I mean, I've been to some other gardens here in Salt Lake City since I visited, and like, you know, some of the vegetable gardens had like powdery mildew. Like, I don't see any powdery mildew in his vegetable garden, which is amazing. So you wanna talk about some of the disease resistance you've seen by, you know, having good soil fertility and having healthy plants?
Yeah, it's amazing. So I've had morning glory, which a lot of viewers will know about. It's not in every state, thank God. So it's one of the worst weeds you can get. There's not almost any use for it. You can use it as rope to tie shit up. Sorry for my language. Tie stuff up, but it will decay and break, so then it doesn't work for rope either. So we plant stuff and we'll leave weeds that we can use that are good for mulch or good for eating, or so like purslane or anything like this. We'll leave those, but morning glory is a super powdery mildew attractant in our area. It will get powdery mildew with three rains, with anything. It just always attracts powdery mildew. And then eventually, if you leave it, it will start to hop to other plants and start to attract them. So I did an experiment. We would always attack the morning glory to get it out for the powdery mildew. So then we did an experiment to grow a cucumber right next to the powdery mildewed morning glory, watered the cucumber with aloe vera, not even on like a regular basis, just whenever I get around to it pretty much. And those cucumber plants didn't get a hint or nothing of powdery mildew, not a spot. And they are literally weaved within each other. And I have, even with compost tea, I have never given compost tea to plants and made them not get powdery mildew. It definitely helps prevent this, but the aloe vera, it seemed like it just boosted the immune system to where the powdery mildew was like a virus, and it just kept shedding it away. It like us, we wouldn't let us get a cold virus. It just wouldn't catch it. So it just has brought up the immune system of the plant to the next level for me.
Awesome. Yeah. I mean, I would encourage you guys also, you know, when you eat yourself, right, eat a wide variety of foods, including the aloe vera. I had a nice glass of aloe vera juice earlier today. You know, and when there's deficiencies in your soil or in you, you know, you're not going to be as healthy as you can. And I mean, plants, they have an immune system, believe it or not. I mean, they've been on this planet for millions of years. They've had to fight off powdery mildew and all these diseases, and they've learned how to, you know, be strong if they have the right inputs and they don't have what we would call nutritional deficiencies. Another thing that I really didn't get to show you guys that I wanted to show you guys earlier was, you know, Rory has some kale plants that he planted right next to each other, that some he planted with the aloe vera, that he watered with aloe vera, and some he did not. And Rory, do you want to share with what happened? I mean, I could have showed you guys, but I didn't, and I could vouch for this.
So there's a brand new established bed this year made, brand new, pure compost only on top of the dirt, and then half of it has wood chips, the other half doesn't. Just all experiments, like everything. So I thought I might do another experiment. We planted three kales, four kales, sorry, and three of them I didn't give any aloe to, and one of them I gave aloe to just every time I was around giving it to all these other plants. So watered this one with aloe. It grew probably three times bigger?
At least, yeah.
At least 3 to 4 times bigger than the other ones. All the other ones, one of the other three was completely ravaged, completely dead, no leaves from aphids, nothing. The other two, John saw just immensely caked with aphids, every single bit. And then the one that had aloe vera, that hasn't had aloe vera for over a month, was 4 times bigger, maybe 10% aphids compared to the other ones.
So the next question I have for you, Rory, is, you know, talking about the aloe again, how often should somebody apply the aloe and water it into their plants, and how often should somebody apply the compost tea for that matter?
Yeah, with the aloe vera, it's just like a human. You could literally water it every single watering. They love it. Just like with human beings, if you drink aloe every day, you will feel energy, you feel alive. And that's what it does to these plants. You give them aloe and it brings them, just gives them that kick of energy that they need to thrive. And then with compost tea, I do that about, if I'm really, really trying to do compost tea, I'll do it once a month to 2 times a month. And this year it was about just hit and miss, probably 2 to 3 times through the season.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, I try to do compost tea once a week. If I'm able to do that, it doesn't always happen. I usually at least do it once I plant my plants, and I think that's one of the most important times I plant them, once they're baby transplants, and just get them doused with the compost tea. I haven't started doing aloe yet, but you know, maybe you get on a cycle where you do 1 week you do aloe, 1 week you do compost tea, and kind of just rotate them in. I think that'd probably be a really good plan. So I guess one of the last questions I want to ask you, Rory, today is, you know, why do you think it is important to model nature, and maybe, for example, you know, and maybe not like add these chemical fertilizers, but like let nature create its own fertility with your assistance?
Yeah. So all we're doing is trying to create a redwood forest, pretty much, but we're helping it along by putting the mulch down even faster than it can be created. So when you're doing that, all I'm trying to do is build a forest scene almost to where the soil can water, feed, search for nutrients, search for water in the soil, search for anything it needs to itself. And I feel when the plants are more in this mode of looking for water themselves, you get more nutrient uptake and you get more tougher growth, I could say. Like the plant is actually can take more problems. When you're sitting there watering the plant every day, it's like almost like being on an IV. You're like sitting there getting everything given to you, especially when you're on synthetic nutrients. It's like you're on the IV. So to say the brain of the plant isn't even on, the nervous system, the function of the plant isn't working because it's almost IV state, to where it's been given everything it needs and it's just sitting there to grow. Almost, to me, it's almost like the plant's in a coma. And this way, you don't water and the plant comes to life. It starts to literally almost like think for itself, find nutrients to dig, to mine for different things, to make these connections with the mycorrhizae, to go out for the microbes, to bring in water and nutrients, to connect to the next plant. Why would a plant need to connect to its neighbor if everything it supposedly needs is thrown on it every time? And then this way, the plants connect to each other because the roots intertwine, they touch, they breathe each other's CO2 and all that great stuff. So I just feel like it's more natural and the plants know what to do when they have to do the work.
Yeah, I mean, I would definitely agree. You know, I like to set up my garden with the proper nutrition, because just if you just start digging up your backyard, there may not just be the nutrients in your backyard, you know, it's been bulldozed already when they built your house, you know, to optimally, you know, grow some of the healthiest plants. So that's why I like to bring in some of these nutrients. And as much as I like the wood chips, the nutrients created by the wood chips, you know, it can cause some challenges. So I like to bring in pre-composted wood chip matter and add that into my garden as fungal dominated compost instead of just adding the wood chips on top. Actually, I wanted to talk to you about that real quick, Rory, is, you know, I know when you brought in some wood chips, you maybe had some challenges with some pests, yeah. Right? And what would happen with that? You want to share that with my viewers?
So when I first brought in the wood chips, just like John was saying, and he said on lots of different videos, that the wood chips, they kind of harbor some slugs and bugs of this issue that are kind of a pain. So I noticed that when I put the wood chips down the first year, the slugs definitely increase, I don't know, fivefold maybe.
Wow.
They increase pretty bad, but I kind of just let nature take its course, and the things that had the resistance, they didn't get slug damage. So I still got food crops. The next year, the slugs went down immensely. And then this year, there's almost hardly any slug problem. So it almost seems like the first year, it gives them a home, but then the first year, it also is giving homes to all these other insects and animals and stuff that want to eat the slugs. So you can maybe, if you live in the right area, get hedgehogs coming in, which would be awesome because they're super slug eaters. So you could get anything like this, snakes, little insects, but then when you get down to it, the microbes, they actually make it harder for the slugs too. When it's almost like if a bug wants to kill your plant or attack it, the microbes want to live on that plant and live with it. So they will literally fight back for you against this bug, that bug, and try and stop them. And you might think I'm like crazy, but you can get online here and you can watch videos of microbe bugs attacking spider mites and attacking insects that attack your garden. So compost tea in this, you're actually putting these microbes on your trees, on your plants, and then those bugs come and the microbes are like, nah, I don't want you here. So it's kind of cool in that sense that you put the wood chips down, it lets the slugs come in, which sucks, but then all the diversity comes after that with it, and then it starts to balance its whole self out. So it's kind of give and take here and there until you get the balancing act, I guess.
Yeah, cool. And basically what we're really doing is we're just trying to model nature and bring back nature and all the different creatures in nature that would be auto-balancing. Nature's auto-balancing, right? There's no, like, nothing that doesn't get composted in nature except for plastic man-made crap. So the day is coming to an end. I actually got to go and maybe get some dinner tonight. But I thought I'd ask Rory one last question. So, Rory, is there anything that you'd like to share to all my other GYG viewers out there? Any words of wisdom or anything, you know, that you want to share with anybody today?
Life's a big experiment, and live it like it's an experiment with fun.
Yeah.
Just, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work, and try something different next year. And then if it works, it takes a while for it to work. You can't drink one glass of aloe vera and think it's gonna make you feel better. You have to feed the aloe vera, and just like John said, build the soil, build the life, and then if the experiment works for you, go with it. If it doesn't, pull the wood chips off and start over, do something different for you. But that's just all I can say is life's a big experiment, just have fun.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely agree. You want to have fun in life and experiment, you know, not only in your garden, but maybe like with your diet, and always experiment with new and different foods. The aloe vera that you could drink. If I remember, I'll post a link down below to the video I made about aloe vera. I spent a good afternoon there learning about aloe vera, sharing all the information with you guys. That was definitely a fun episode. But yeah, as much as aloe vera is so good, there's so many other different foods that I want you guys to have fun with and play with. And I mean, that's one of the most important words for a gardener is to always have fun. You know, life is not a chore. To me, it's a joy, right? And to me, to visit a garden, get my hands dirty when I'm on vacation, that's a joy to me, right? And to be able to experiment in your garden and try new things just to see what happens and have curiosity, just like, you know, his two-year-old is running around doing all kind of crazy stuff, right? Have some curiosity, because I think when you lose the fun, you lose, you know, yourself asking questions and questioning things and trying new things, I think that's truly when you're 6 feet under. All right. So in any case, if you guys enjoyed this episode today, want me to come back out to Rory's, make more videos, because there's so many other things I could have showed you. Maybe it'd be better if I came during the growing season.
Definitely.
Please be sure to give me a thumbs up to let me know. Also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below to be notified of my new and upcoming episodes I have coming out about every 3 to 4 days. And I'll also be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. You know, Rory's has watched a lot of them and has gleaned a lot of information from it, from my videos, and I know you guys can too. If you take a look at some of those guys, I mean, they go back, I don't even know how many years now, like 8 years. I've been doing this for quite a while. But any case, with that, I gotta get going, getting kind of chilly here in Salt Lake City in the evening. So once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.
All right, this is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and this one is a garden update. It's currently October, end of the season. As you guys can see, things are going crazy here.